Now that we've learned how energy gets into sugar molecules, let's spend some time talking about how we release that energy within our cells. Let's discuss cellular respiration. Cellular respiration is the process of breaking down food molecules in order to get energy. Cellular respiration has three steps. Those steps are glycolysis. The Krebs cycle, also known as the citric acid cycle. And also oxidative phosphorylation, which is also sometimes simply referred to as the electron transport chain. So let's start talking about what's really going to be happening during cellular respiration. Cellular respiration is known as aerobic respiration because it's done in the presence of oxygen gas. The breakdown of sugar molecules for energy is most efficient when oxygen gas is present. For this reason, it's called aerobic respiration. In this process, the high-energy electrons are transferred from sugar to oxygen. And in this transfer from these organic molecules to oxygen, they release energy. Now you may be wondering, why does electron transfer from organic molecules to oxygen release energy? This all has to go back to the concept of electrons having certain amounts of stored energy based on their position. The amount of energy stored in an electron depends on the molecules they are a part of, which again determines the position of those electrons. When electrons move from glucose to oxygen, it is as though they were falling. They're moving from a higher energy state to a lower energy state. This fall of electrons releases energy during cellular respiration. Now you may wonder, well, how much energy can really be released by these electrons simply falling? Well, gasoline and gunpowder operate under the very same principle. High energy electrons are transferred to oxygen gas, and in that process, they release energy. In fact, if all of that energy from our food molecules were released in a single burst of energy, that would destroy our cells. The path that electrons take on their way down from glucose to oxygen involves many steps. Each step releases small amounts of energy, which the cell is able to collect and use. As I had mentioned, if all of this energy were released in a single step, it would end up destroying the cell instead of allowing the cell to power its activities. Just as photosynthesis occurred in a specific organelle in plants, in that case the chloroplast, cellular respiration occurs in the mitochondria of all eukaryotic cells. And this is another important thing to emphasize. While only plants and certain protists photosynthesize, all eukaryotic cells have mitochondria, and all eukaryotic cells perform cellular respiration, even plant cells. The first step of cellular respiration is known as glycolysis. Glycolysis does not happen in the mitochondria itself, but it does happen next to the mitochondria, right adjacent to it. Whereas the last two steps, the Krebs cycle and oxidative phosphorylation, they definitely occur within the mitochondria itself. So let's talk about this first step, of cellular respiration, glycolysis. Well, the prefix glyco means sugar, and lysis means to break apart. So the name itself literally tells us we're breaking apart sugar. And in glycolysis, we take glucose, which is a six-carbon molecule, and split it into two molecules of pyruvate, which is a three-carbon molecule. This process, taking a larger, more complex molecule and breaking it into smaller pieces, will release energy. And the energy that's released in this process are a net increase of plus two ATP and plus two molecules of NADH. While there is an initial investment of a few ATP to get this process started, again, that's the activation energy, the net result is plus two molecules of ATP and plus two molecules of NADH. And we also still have these two molecules of pyruvate, which have a lot of stored energy. It's these pyruvate molecules that then move on to the second step of cellular respiration, known as the Krebs cycle. So the Krebs cycle, or the citric acid cycle, takes the pyruvate that was made in glycolysis and breaks it down all the way into carbon dioxide, or CO2. There's a series of reactions here where high energy electrons are taken away, some molecules of ATP are made, and eventually carbon dioxide is released. This cycle can repeat over and over again. Recall that we received two pyruvate for each round of glycolysis, so this cycle will happen twice for each molecule of glucose that we start with. The enzyme-driven steps result in three carbon dioxide, four NADH, one FADH2, and one ATP molecule per pyruvate molecule. So if we go to look at the total outcome of breaking down our glucose down into carbon dioxide, we had one glucose, we broke it down into two pyruvate molecules in glycolysis. Each pyruvate then runs through the Krebs cycle, and we end up with six molecules of CO2, eight molecules of reduced NADH, two molecules of reduced FADH2, two molecules of ATP. If we add to this the energy we got from glycolysis, which was plus 2 NADH and plus 2 ATP, we see when it's all said and done, they only have four molecules of ATP at this point. That's really not a lot of energy. So where was all that energy that was stored in the sugar? Well, the answer is it's in all these shuttle bus molecules. It's these molecules that will take the high energy electrons to the last step of cellular respiration, which is oxidative phosphorylation. We'll talk about that in the next video.